My heart a Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Oh, once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing, there ain't nothing gonna stay.
I've celebrated, sweet drink I've tasted, they come and go.
Let it be stronger. Let it be. Hey, before we start the service of worship this morning, let's all stand up. Let's stand up. We got to get blood flowing, right?
Let's stand up and let's greet one another.
Well,
I don't like it down here.
Wait till I start talking about sin.
I feel out of place.
You're always in place. You're always in place. Wherever you are, you're in place. Well, again, welcome in the name of Christ. And for y'all who are streaming in, welcome. I'm glad you're worshiping with us this morning. Hope you have a good and a meaningful time, but we're glad you're with us this morning. Now, before we start the service of worship, we've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Understand that we are, Paula, talk about what the Brunch Bunch is going to be doing in a couple of weeks.
Is this on? Okay. On September 15th, we're going to go up 322, stop in Corsica at a quilt and craft shop, go to Luigi's and Du Bois to eat whatever, and then we're going to go to an antique shop and another craft gift shop in Du Bois. And then on October 2nd is the play Matilda that we'll go to in Franklin. And I think we're going to eat afterwards at Primo Baroni's. And also, we had a great trip to the Sunflower Field in Foxburg on this past Thursday. And anybody that in the Brunch Bunch that went and helped to pick out these flowers, you can take a couple home with you.
Thank you. And if you want to see any pictures of the Brunch Bunch wandering through fields of sunflowers, you could go to the church blog, because we've got some pictures up on the blog. So, but take note to the two events, one going to the craft and quilt place and the other Matilda. And if you haven't seen Matilda as a musical, it's really good. So think about seeing that. We'll be doing that in Franklin. And Carrie, would you share about Sunday school that's going to be starting in about 3 weeks?
So we're going to start Sunday school kickoff September 18th. We're a week late this year because I'm going to be on vacation. So we're going to be continuing with Fruit of the Spirit for the first few weeks. Then we have some other stuff we're going to do towards the end of the year.
Now that's going to be really exciting to working on it because we're preaching on it and during the worship service too. So we're all kind of coordinating together. Now there's an announcement on the back of your bulletin about the Sunday school. And if anybody would like flyers to pass out, let me know. We can get you as many as you need. So are there any other announcements that anybody here might have before we get started?
The church provided the staff over at Sligo Elementary with donuts on Thursday, and several of the staff members told me how thoughtful and kind they thought that was and how appreciative they are. So thank you very much.
It's hard to believe that teachers eat donuts. Yeah, boy. So that's good. But we did provide it for the elementary school. So, yes.
Attention. Well, the Reimersburg, I'm just going to read it here. The Reimersburg Sligo Association Churches, which I sit on their board, is reaching out to various churches in Clarion County to ask for an umbrella drive for the release time program. And I'm sure you are all familiar with the release time program if you had kids and grandkids. And they use our church. They come during a period for to learn about God and just get some, you know, instruction and church things, and it's been attended 98% over the years, and it's been going on for 68 years, and he actually said, and this number kind of surprised me, 75% of these kids don't have a regular church to go to, so it's a ministry we can reach out and maybe, you know, get them involved in the church and stuff. But they need umbrellas because Mr. Minnick brought it to our attention, our principal, that when it rains, they cancel it and they can't come. They have to walk from the school across the bridge, and that's another thing we need replaced too. You know, we need to be working on that. But they're raising money for umbrellas. If the church wants to donate, if you as individuals want to donate, you can bring the umbrellas here. I'll make sure that they get to the proper place. And actually, they have a box at Riverside also. They're collecting umbrellas also. And there's some information here, who to mail checks to. They just ask you to write in the memo, umbrellas. And I'll hang this up. And there's numbers and phone numbers, or just me. I'd be able to get you.
I'll leave that. Let me make a copy of it. We'll put it up online, and we'll have it in the bulletin next week. So yes, thank you. And that's really important because the kids, you know, in the rain, they're not able to come. So let's provide some umbrellas for them to come over. 200 umbrellas. Okay. In Reimersburg. Okay. Any other announcements? So thank you, Scott. Any other announcements? Well then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together.
Thank you.
Now, even though that said, be still, we're going to be getting up and singing a little bit. So as we sort of get into the worship service, let's everybody stand and let's sing a couple of songs. And we'll start by singing, In My Heart There Rings a Melody. Good, and still standing, let's sing together, Sanctuary. Y'all may be seated, and would the young people come on up and have a seat right around me, right here. Okay, have a seat, have a seat. Come on down, guys. Oh, man. How are y'all doing today? You're doing well, you're doing well. Anything new or exciting happen in this last week? Anything new, big happen last week? Do anything special? Let me ask you, was there any change in your routine during the last week? I mean, did you happen to do something you hadn't done in like 3 months in the last week? What does that mean? Was there anything different that you did this week that you didn't do the week before? No. No. So did any of y'all go to school last week? Okay. You went to school last week. How was it for you? Now, did y'all go to school too? Preschool? You didn't go yet. Oh, you just met your teacher? Okay. I bet she's nice. I bet your teacher's nice, yeah. Teachers are nice. Teachers are really nice. And I'm not saying that just because I'm married to one. They really are nice. I am married to one. Didn't you know that? Yeah. She doesn't teach. Okay, but she goes.
She helps.
So she's a helper. Okay. She does more than just hangs around, though, right? Yeah. Well, let me ask you, because you two are veterans of school, right? Well, I mean, but she just started a couple of days ago. How was school? Now, y'all are in second grade. What have you learned in second grade that you didn't know before? We are evaluating modern education. So what did you learn in the first week, second week that you had? What's that? Oh, what's wrong with your toe? Oh. Well, it looks fine, but does it hurt? No. Okay, well, that's good. Did you learn anything in second grade that you didn't know before? Not really? You didn't learn anything? Not yet. But you might learn something in the future. Hey, what about you, London? This was the first week in kindergarten. How did that go? Yeah. How was kindergarten? Good? Do you think you'll keep going? Yeah, I would if I were you. I would if I were you. Okay, you know what we're going to talk about? Have you ever heard the word peace?
Yes.
Have you? You've heard the word peace before? Oh, very good. Yeah, peace. That's kind of, Grayson, it looks like you've done that before. You know, peace. That's what we used to say back in the 60s and 70s. We'd say, peace, man. That's what we'd say, peace, man. Yeah, that's what we said. Peace. I didn't make it. We also said things like groovy. You know, I can dig it. It was a lot, huh? No, I was born in the 50s. Yeah, that's what we did. Yeah, that's kind of, yes, you're kind of taking, y'all kind of have a meditative peace. Well, you know, we're going to, in fact, what's that? Your mom was born in the 80s? Well, that was good that your mom was born in the 80s. She told you? I think she told you. I'm not sure she wanted you to tell everybody else. Yeah. She was born like 30 years after. I'd be willing to bet you she really may not have wanted that shared. What did you say, 32? Yeah, that's about right. Anyway, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about peace. And you know why people, you know why y'all were doing this? Because when you feel peace inside, what happens? When you start feeling peace, what happens to you on the inside? If we all go like this, feel peace, what happens to us on the inside? We kind of feel kind of calm down. We don't worry about things quite so much. Oh, you have to cut your nails? Okay, well, you know, when you're feeling peace, that helps. To cut, you know, when you're cutting your neck. Just feel peace. And when you're all fired up and stirred up and all upset, you know what you can do? Just feel peace. And peace is one of those gifts given to us by God, and it's called a spiritual what? It's called a fruit of the Spirit. That's exactly right, because you're talking about, that's what we're going to talk about today. Self-control. That's, you got it. That's really good. All right, let's have a word of prayer, and then I'm going to give you something to work on, and then you can get some crayons and do her. Okay, so let's bow our heads. Everybody bow our heads, and we want to feel peace when we pray. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us this time together. And help us when, especially when we're all upset and things are going on and our minds are racing, help us to feel peace. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, let's stand up. Stand up. And here. And here. And here. Well, I'll give you, yes. That's, yeah. Take this. Here, and we take this, and you'll take you one more. Okay, and let's see. Oh, that was my fault. Okay, all right. Now you've got to. You've already got to. All right. What do we want to say today? Okay. We're going to say, God loves us. God loves us. God loves us. Yeah, that's good. At the end, say yay. God loves us, and we're back to school. Yay. Okay? All right. Turn around. Okay, I want you all to have a great week, wonderful week. And what do I want you to remember all week?
God loves us, back to school, yay! Yeah.
Back to school, yay. So go ahead and get your crayons. And thank you, Jordan. Very, very good. Now, God's given us the opportunity to lift our prayers to Him. Here, you can pass these out and some crayons and stuff to work on. And you can show me after the service. God's given us the opportunity to approach Him in prayer and to share with Him our needs and concerns. Now, you got a whole bunch of them in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Are there other needs that we might want to remember today and into the next week?
I just want to clear up some confusion on some people's parts. Why I'm sitting in the middle and not over where I usually do is the joy to see all these new faces here this Sunday morning.
Yes, very good.
I also have a concern. Bus is going to have a defibrillator placed on Friday, so he needs prayer.
We want to remember to pray for Bus as he has his defibrillator replaced. Now, Ellen, you said you were sitting there so you could make faces at me. Oh, that was when you were going to sit in the front. I got you. Are there other needs that we want to remember this week?
I just wanted to say today is Ron's 80th birthday. And he's still putting along here, so that's a good thing.
That's a good thing. Yes. Absolutely. So we want to remember Ron's birthday today. Thank you. Anything else we want to remember in prayer? Good news, news not so good. Well, then let's go to God now in prayer. And since in just a little bit we're going to hear God's word read and proclaimed, so we'll confess as a part of preparing. We'll share with God some of the things that we may have done or left undone for which we need forgiveness. And then y'all will have the opportunity to lift your concerns to God, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go to God now in prayer. Lord God, you are present with us because you're with us all the time. And we are incredibly grateful. We never want to take that for granted. You know, Lord, sometimes living in the world in which we live, sometimes we feel very little peace. We don't feel peace within ourselves because there's so much going on and so many concerns that we have and worries that we buy into, and it just keeps us stirred up inside all the time. So we don't feel much peace within, and then between folks, doesn't seem like there's a lot of peace there either. Sometimes we feel hostility towards those who disagree with us just because they disagree with us, and that isn't good. And this lack of peace, well, sometimes we don't feel it even as we approach you. We see you as a God who will slap us down if we step out of line, not one who loves us very much, but one who disciplines us. And that's fine when things are going well, but when things aren't, you know, causes us to be a little afraid and sad and frustrated. So as we go about living our lives, there's not a whole lot of peace around us. And when we buy into the chaos and the hostility and the fear, we're actually turning away from this wonderful gift that you've given us, the opportunity that you've planted inside of all of us to feel a sense of calmness both within ourselves and as we look out into our world. And so when we buy into this fear and chaos that we see around us, we ask for your forgiveness. We also ask that you redirect our thoughts and our feelings so that we can experience some of the peace that you offer. We ask this in the name of Christ. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're also going to lift up to you those needs that are in the bulletin and those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us now as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us, and thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, Lord, thank you for forgiving us, and we know we've been forgiven. And thank you for responding to our needs, and we know you'll do that as well. Because we've lifted these needs up to you in the name of Christ our Savior, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, would the ushers come down to collect our offering?
Anybody out there got some troubles? Anybody out there got some heartache? Me too. Just when you think it can't get any worse, somehow it gets worse. But my friend, hold on. When it feels like I might have a breakdown, I got a friend closer than a brother. Say, lay down your burdens, your heartache, your hurting. It may not make sense, but here in this mess, I have peace. I have peace, peace that surpasses understanding. I know life's out of my hands, but I'll make it through, 'cause I got a you. When my world's in a thousand pieces, Jesus, you're the only reason I have peace. Let me go a little further, I'm about to break it down. Every life has two choices, yeah, you can let go, or you can control. I chose to let go, now deep in my soul, I have peace.
Peace is Jesus, you're the
Lord God, thank you for giving us the opportunity to make this offering to you. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation that our gifts may be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Well, we are about to bring the curtain down on the summer, right? Of course, I understand that officially, that's not going to happen until, what's the date? September 22nd, which, by the way, is also my anniversary, I think. Now, that's official. Unofficially, well, it won't occur, the changing of the season, until after Labor Day, right? You know, that day where you're not supposed to wear shoes, white shoes. Yeah, you got to wear shoes after. That would be silly. White shoes after, right, for about 7 months. And so even though we've got anywhere from, 8 to 26 days to go, I'll tell you, once school starts and once football begins, summer is over, right? And it doesn't matter that we're going to be pushing 90 degrees later this afternoon. But you know, even though we're at the end of a season going into another one, that we have either enjoyed or endured for the last 3 months, this morning we are continuing a series we started on the Sunday that followed our vacation Bible school. And it's a series that's focused on this passage from Paul's letter to the Galatians. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is, and if kids, some of y'all want to say it with me, you can. Fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. Now, that's what we've been doing. And during the last couple of weeks, we've looked at the first two spiritual gifts, starting with what? Love, that's right. And it's something that we said was essential and active and godly. And then last week, we focused on joy, right? And talked about how it's given and empowering. And of course, joy is, remember the last one? Contagious. And remember, you could find both the sermons and the services on our Facebook page and YouTube channel and church blog, and the addresses for all of that's in your bulletin. Now, that's where we've been. And today we're going to look at Paul's third fruit of the Spirit, and now I'm talking about peace, right? And I'll tell you personally, I think that's a good thing because from where I stand, peace sure seems to be in short supply in our world today, right? For example, I see a lot of people who seem to lack, you know, what you could call a sense of inner peace. I know, speaking for myself, and my wife would reinforce this, there are times that I feel my mind is very, very restless, right? And then when it finally settles on something, it's often a problem I've got to solve or a disappointment I can't seem to shake. And that's probably why I'm not always as patient as I should be. And I don't sleep very well at night. Man, if I'm honest with myself, inner peace is something that I struggle with, particularly around 3:30 in the morning when I wake up and can't go back to sleep. I'm not feeling a lot of inner peace. But frankly, from talking to some of y'all and just getting to know, I don't think I'm unique in that. I think that lack of inner peace is something that we kind of carry around. Like I said, it's in short supply in our world nowadays. And since, you know, we have a hard time finding it on the inside, it really shouldn't come as any surprise that it's often not seen on the outside either. I mean, I don't think I'm stepping out on any kind of limb when I say this, but I'm not sure that anybody would describe ours as a peaceful society nowadays. Not with all the violent crimes we see every night on television. And not with all the juvenile name-calling our leaders seem to engage in. And not with all the out-and-out hostility we are supposed to feel towards anyone who doesn't share our beliefs and assumptions and opinions. As I heard a guy say on one of the sports radio shows I listen to, like it or not, we have become a coarse society. We have become a coarse society, and coarse societies don't have much peace. And I'll tell you, this lack of inner and this lack of social peace, well, I think it extends to how we feel as we approach God. I mean, for some folks, God is more like a punitive parent than he is a loving father, right? And even though that may be great when you're on his good side, what happens when things turn south a little bit? I mean, what happens when we find ourselves facing the same kind of stuff we assume only applies to people that neither we nor God likes very much? My gosh, what happens when our opinion of God is shaken like a martini in a James Bond movie? What happens then? Let's just say that peace is kind of scarce, even in rural Pennsylvania. And yet, it's also the third spiritual gift offered by Paul. Therefore, it must be present whether we recognize it or not. And that's what we're going to talk about for the next 10 minutes or so. You see, we're going to consider how the kind of peace that comes from God can change us. That's what we're going to focus on. And to do that, we're going to look at some scripture, kind of like we did last week. And hopefully, by the time we leave here this morning, we're going to see and understand how claiming the peace that comes from God, and I'm talking about the spiritual peace about which Paul wrote, how that peace can change us in three pretty profound ways. For example, when we claim this spiritual fruit, I believe we'll experience more peace with God. More peace with God. Now, that's the first way it's going to change our lives. In other words, instead of the disappointment and instead of the anxiety, instead of all the doubt we end up feeling from time to time, when we think God has let us down and when we begin to ask ourselves why, we can actually feel some comfort and serenity and confidence when God's peace kicks in. And you know, I think this kind of peace with God is firmly established in Scripture. I mean, according to the prophet Isaiah, the Lord gives perfect peace to those whose faith is firm. So always trust the Lord because he is forever almighty. And you know, I think Paul said about the same thing to the Philippians when he wrote this. He wrote, always be glad because of the Lord. I will say it again, be glad. Always be glad, gentle with others. The Lord will soon be here. Don't worry about anything, but pray about everything. With thankful hearts, offer your prayers and requests to God. Then, because you belong to Christ Jesus, God will bless you with what? Peace. That no one can completely understand. And this peace will control the way you think and feel. You see, when we decide to put aside our beliefs, some of our beliefs, and when we decide to put aside some of our assumptions, and when we decide to put aside some of our opinions, and when we claim the joy that God offers, and when we begin to see ourselves as we are seen, in other words, as imperfect people who belong to Jesus in spite of ourselves, we're going to start feeling peace with God. And I'll tell you why feeling that peace with God is important. You see, I believe this peace enables us to trust. I mean, isn't that what Isaiah said? You see, peace enables us to have faith that, as Paul wrote to the Romans, Christ died for us at a time when we were helpless and sinful. And peace enables us to believe that, as Paul wrote to the Ephesians, you were saved by faith in God who treats us much better than we deserve. This is God's gift to you, and not anything you've done on your own. It isn't something you have earned, so there is nothing for you to brag about. And I believe, as sure as I'm standing here, that peace with God, that peace we can feel with God, enables us to trust that, again, as Paul wrote to the Romans, nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm telling you, this is going to happen when we recognize and understand and claim peace with God. And that's the first way we'll change. And second, I believe claiming this spiritual fruit will also help us experience more peace with those around us. You know, even those folks with whom we feel some hostility and anger. In other words, with the kind of peace that comes from God, we're going to be able to get beyond the violence. The violence that we see and the name-calling that we hear and the hostility we feel, instead, because we understand that none of us are that good in the sight of God, much less perfect, we can look for opportunities to make peace with others. And you know, this desire to be peacemakers, man, that was an important theme in the Bible. I mean, just listen to what the psalmist wrote. He wrote, "Come, my children, listen as I teach you to respect the Lord. Do you want to live and enjoy a long life? Then don't say cruel things and don't tell lies. Do good instead of evil and try to live at peace." Now, I'll tell you, that's what peacemaking is all about. Trying to live in peace with those around us. And as a writer to the letter of the letter to the Hebrews said, try to live at peace with everyone. Live a clean life. If you don't, you will never see the Lord. Make sure no one misses out on God's wonderful kindness. Don't let anyone become bitter and cause trouble for the rest of you. And finally, remember, this attitude must have been important to Jesus Christ himself. Because in the Beatitudes, you remember the Beatitudes? He said, God blesses people who make peace. They will be called his children. You see, the more we claim the peace that comes from God, the more we're going to start making peace with others. And you know, isn't that desire to make peace? Isn't that necessary if we're serious about showing love? I mean, without a knowledge of peace, without feeling peace towards those around us, how can we understand what John meant in his first letter when he wrote? We love God because God loved us first. But if we say we love God but don't love each other, we are, you know the next word? Liars. We cannot see God. So how can we love God if we don't love the people we can see? And how can we understand without peace? How can we believe that Peter was right when he wrote, most important of all, you must sincerely love each other because love wipes away many sins. And without peace, how can we ever decide that we are actually going to obey the command that Jesus Christ gave his disciples, and I'll tell you, through them to us. But I am giving you a new commandment. You must love each other just as I have loved you. You see, I think this kind of love is only possible. In other words, it's only possible for us to be the kind of men and women God has called and created us to be. Man, that's only possible when we accept that through God we can live in peace with one another. And that's the second way we'll change. And third, right along with feeling peace with God and peace with one another, when we claim this fruit of the Spirit, I believe we'll experience a whole lot more peace within ourselves. You know, on the inside, within our minds, and within our hearts. In other words, it's actually through the assurance that God loves us, warts and all, that we'll be able to attain that state of consciousness experienced by those great American philosophers of my generation who wrote, "'Cause I got a peaceful, easy feeling, and I know you won't let me down. Because I'm already standing on the what? Ground. We should have lighters. I'm in. Now, that's inner peace. And I'll tell you, let's face it, that's a whole lot more profound than anything you'll find in Desperado or Wicked or Witchy Woman. You see, this is the same kind of peace that Jesus promised his disciples when he said, I give you peace, the kind of peace only I can give. It isn't the peace that the world can give, so don't be worried or afraid. And a little bit later, he offered the reason we can feel this peace. He said, the time will come and is already here when all of you will be scattered. Each of you will go back home and leave me by myself, but the Father will be with me and I won't be alone. I have told you this so that you might have peace in your hearts because of me. While you are in the world, you'll have to suffer. But cheer up. I have defeated the world. And you know, when you think about it, isn't the kind of thing we're talking about here, isn't it the same kind of gentle assurance that King David felt when he wrote this psalm? And friends, if you want to say these words with me, please do. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You see, this is the kind of inner peace that's possible when we claim this fruit And because it's available, now we can feel hope. I mean, give me a break. I think it's virtually impossible to look into the future and see anything that is positive or have any positive feelings when we are restless and impatient and when we're focused on problems and disappointments. We are not going to look into the future and feel positive. But I'll tell you, when we recognize what Jesus said and what he promised, and when we understand that he was and is and will always be greater than the world, and when we accept that God was and is and will always be our shepherd and we are his sheep, then I believe genuine hope is possible. I mean, when we get it, when we get our heads around what Paul was saying, when we feel this peace, we'll be able to understand what Paul was getting at when he wrote to the Romans. And this hope is what saves us. And if we already have what we hope for, there is no need to keep on hoping. However, we hope for something we have not yet seen, and we wait patiently for it. And I'll tell you, when we feel this kind of peace, then we'll understand what he meant when he said, "Let your hope make you glad. Be patient in time of trouble and never stop praying." And finally, we'll know exactly what he meant when he said, "I pray that God who gives hope will bless you with complete happiness and peace because of your faith. And may the power of the Holy Spirit fill you with hope." You see, this is going to happen. This is going to happen when we claim the inner peace that God offers. And that's a third change that I think we're going to see. Now, like I said a little while ago, we are moving into an entirely different time of year, right? I mean, regardless of what the calendar might say and what those immutable rules about white shoes after Labor Day, right now we are leaving summer and entering fall. But even though the seasons are changing, doesn't mean that we're going to change. I mean, we can still move forward and feel confusion as we look at ourselves and frustration as we consider others and even concern as we approach God. In fact, I'm telling you, this is a kind of baggage we can carry around for the rest of our lives if we choose to do it. But brothers and sisters, believe the good news. This is something we don't have to do. Instead, we can claim this fruit of the Spirit about which Paul wrote. And we can experience more peace with God, which enables us to trust. And we can experience more peace with one another that will enable us to love. And we can experience more peace within ourselves, which will enable us to hope. You see, in these ways, we can change when we decide to cultivate peace. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord God, your word is clear and direct. You offer us peace. My goodness gracious, you offer us peace. And it's a peace we can claim, and when we claim it, we're going to feel more peace as we approach you. We're going to feel more peace as we deal with others. And we're going to feel more peace as we look within ourselves. So, Lord God, give us the insight and give us the courage and give us the awareness to claim it. We ask this in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Now, before we close the service with a final song, let me offer you all this invitation. If there's anybody here who might feel the grace of Jesus Christ and is interested in how he or she might respond, talk to me after the service. If you've got a question about the sermon or the service itself, come and talk to me about that as well. Let's now all stand and let's bring the service home by singing "Sunshine in My Soul." and be challenged. Be challenged to claim the peace that's already here. And allow that peace to shape how you see God and how you see one another and how you see yourself. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. Amen.